So let me introduce to you Professor Enrico Alleva, who is busy with technical problem. Enrico Alleva is an Italian ethologist. He has been president of the Italian Society for the Study of Animal Behavior since 2008. After obtaining his degree in biological sciences at the Sapienza University of Rome, Alleva specialized in animal behavior at the Scuola Normale Superiore of Pisa. He is a member of the Scientific Council of ANPA, World Wide Fund for Nature, Lega Ambiente, Stazione Zoologica on Naples, Istituto dell'Enciclopedia Italiana Giovanni Treccani, Agenzia Spaziale, CNR, Department Scienze della Vita, Commissione Antartide. He is a corresponding member of the Accademia dei Lincei and of the Medical Academy of Rome. Alleva was awarded by the G.B. Grassi Prize of the Accademia dei Lincei and the Anokhin Medal of the Russian Academy of Medical Sciences. President of the Stazione Geologica of Naples between 2011 and 2013. Since 1990, he is also the director of the Section of Behavioral Neurosciences of the Istituto Superiore di Sanità in Roma. He is also, I want to add, a very renowned scientist and a friend. And so we are very happy to have him here.
Thank you very much, Guido, for inviting me. Thank you to all of you for coming here, especially those who are so distant from my discipline, like Professor Francesca Matteucci. She's an astrophysicist. And so I will try to cope, because the stress elicits the coping response to put stress under control with such a variable audience. And please interrupt me if anything you don't understand something. I will present a kind of long life work I've been doing, because the story of my life is that before I was 13, I met Rita Levi-Montalcini, because I used to rescue injured birds, and one of my kites landed on her balcony. And so we started a long life collaboration, and I was trained as a neuroscientist when neuroscience was not even mentioned in biology or biomedicine. The first slide. I belong to this rather strange area where we try to put together psychological and biological factors. It's something very difficult to do, so my friend Robert Sapolsky from Stanford, where I've been for a rather long time in the 80s, was just saying about depression, something that some of you are working on also in Trieste, that it's very difficult to disentangle what are considered mental or social factors, inter-individual relationship, and veritable biological, neurobiological factors. And I will present data about NGF. Nerve growth factor, I'm sure that most of you know about this magic protein that was discovered 1 year before I was born by Rita Levi-Montalcini, and she dedicated all her entire life. She was 103 years old when she still was working on that. And you don't see a nerve growth factor here. You see what is the classical bioassay for NGF. This was the only way to measure and to have a quantitative measurement of NGF for decades. And you just add a very few molecules of NGF in the medium. And this is a chick embryo ganglion of the spinal cord. And you see what is known as the halo effect. And you see that dendrites protrude, and so this is the classical halo effect. I want to mention that I work at the Istituto Superiore di Sanità, where our laboratory was founded by Daniel Beauvais, who got the Nobel Prize in 1957, and he was the first to do to try to melt psychology and biology together. She was asked to be a professor in Rome, and I said, I will accept to teach, but I want to teach psychobiology, and this is when psychobiology entered the academic scenario. The main effects of nerve fracture are three. I have to review shortly. One is trophic. If you give NGF to chick embryo, their sympathetic nervous system grow. We now know that this is mainly due to an anti-apoptotic effect, which means that cells, neurons, are committed to die, to commit suicide, but they are stopped by adding NGF. The second effect is an effect that is a little bit forgotten, is a trophic effect. NGF provides the direction toward which neurons grow. One page of science, a cover page of science, was a figure like that of an axon growing by providing small amounts of NGF, and the axon was growing that way. And I proposed to Rita Levi-Montalcini to put her signature and to have a neuron exactly doing the same. And the third effect is quite well known, is that those neurotrophins promote differentiation, which means that one stem cell, we now say stem cells, or neurons, they can shift from being a cholinergic phenotype to an adrenergic phenotype. This depends on the milieu we work on. I want to say that all of my work has been done, we are three, with Rita Levi-Montalcini and Luigi Aloe. We were neighboring, we were living very next, so every single day for years in the evening we go to Rita's place to show the data and to discuss, and this was a privilege. So my story started with a story of NGF, nerve growth factor, that was discovered at the beginning in the snake of a terrible snake, Naya Naya, and the idea of Stanley Cohen, who shared the Nobel Prize with Rita Levi-Montalcini, was to say, oh, it is so difficult to get Naya Naya venom, but this venom is contained in salivary gland of these snakes and other species of snakes. Why don't we try to see if the salivary glands of mice, we have plenty of mice in the lab, contain NGF. This was the case only for male mice. And this was an important step, because it was so easy in those years to have, in the early 50s and 60s, a tissue containing a very high quantity of this protein. So it was easy to purify the protein and then to characterize this protein. So this is the salivary gland. There are these granules, and these granules contain NGF. You see a magnification, and you see those granules in which NGF is contained. And there was, in the literature, was very interesting, because mice, but not rats, had a lot of NGF in their salivary glands. Practically only males showed NGF. And in some cases, NGF was found in the blood of those mice, male mice, but it was incredible, because one laboratory, maybe in Germany, was trying to measure and they failed. Another laboratory in London was publishing in Nature that there was NGF released in blood. And so for, I have to say, years or months, Rita and I were discussing why the hell was so elusive to find NGF in blood. And eventually I came out with the idea, listen, mice, male mice fight, male rats do not fight, female mice do not fight. Is it possible that there is a behavioral factor which is triggering the release of NGF in blood? This is, again, what I was saying before about psychobiology. I was trying to put behavior in a cascade of events in which eventually there was release, a chemical release in blood. And so I have been playing and living in my room with rats and mice all of my life, and so we know very well how it's possible to score through ethological methods mouse behavior. We know that they have some threats, that they have this affiliation, they have some kind of self-maintenance literature, but it's also interesting for some of you that they bite each other, but the very, very terrible biting mice are not males, are female, lactating females. They're really aggressive, and they can kill another mouse. While males, they bite, they do a lot of confrontation, but they never bite on very vulnerable or fatal regions. But for a few days, when the female is nursing, this is because male mice eat pups of the same species, they're infanticidal. So, after 3 years, we characterized and published in PNIS what we were thinking. We have a fighting session, standardized. We have this release of NGF in blood. And you see that is something happening in 1 hour and lasting and then finishing. And we have done these experiments to see what happens. It happens that when we have a limited amount of fighting episodes, NGF release that is very low, and now we may have much more sensitive wave of measuring that. This was in the mid-80s. And then you see that there is a full-blown response after sept-different. But we, as behavioral ethologists, we were interested, and we know that male aggression, especially mice, which are highly territorial, and this is different from rats, which are a colonial, highly social species. We divide attacking mice into different phenotypes. One are dominance animals, and the other is the subordinate animals. We do experiments confronting two animals at the same time. If we expose mice for 10 sessions, we see that at the beginning both fight, but after the fifth session, only one mouse is attacking, and this is the dominant, and the other mouse is simply fleeing. And what we see by a detailed scale of behaviors is that dominant mice, those that will be dominant, they have a lot of this tail rattling behavior, which is a kind of snake tail expression of behavior in which they display a kind of threatening the opponent. And you see that the dominants all the time express this behavior, while the subordinates have very little and then they stop, while other kind of behaviors like aggressive grooming is never displayed by subordinates, while it's consistently displayed by dominants. And this was something we were looking, because someone in the field of the evolution of behavior cannot accept to have simply aggressive animals. They want to understand more. And we were then looking which was the level of NGF in the blood of dominance, subordinate and dominant mice. And in the first experiments, we have that subordinate mice have twice the level of the dominance, but usually there is a much higher level of NGF in the blood. And then we were also characterizing the stress in terms of the nature of stress, and in psychobiology of semi-naturalistic animal behavior in lab, we know that we have some non-psychological stress tests in which animals have to confront with different stressors, but never a conspecific, while we have so-called psychosocial stress, in which male confront male. So these are kind of stress where there is another mouse, which is the stressor. And we see that what is true for NGF, and this has been also shown in humans, is that the non-psychological stress is the one not eliciting NGF release, while the psychological stress is the only one producing NGF. The classical target of stress, especially social stress, is the size of the adrenal glands. And you see what is the normal adrenal gland. And you see what is the adrenal gland of a mouse which has received the NGF for 10 days, exactly mimicking what's happening when you confront for 10 days the animals. And these are more subtle analysis with physiological levels of NGF confronted with cytochrome C, which is a molecule which is physicochemically similar to NGF but lacks its neurotrophic activity. You see that both the cortical and the medullary part of the adrenal gland grow. Then we have done the reverse. We injected NGF in very small amounts in mice, and we found that NGF was actually producing a more subordinate profile, for example, aggressive grooming, which is a very important sensitive measurement for something which is just comes before biting or full-blown attack, is strongly affected. And so we went eventually to that. So we were trying again to put together psychological and neurobiological factor, and the subordinate male releases more NGF than dominance. Their adrenal volume increases, and there is a lot of papers, a great extent of literature about what adrenal products do when they increase and when there is a change in submissive behavior. So corticosterone does not provide subordinate behavior per se, but in the case of a subordination act, it enhances the probability to be a subordinate. And so we presented several years ago this functional loop in which subordinate males tend to enter a loop in which they remain subordinates, while exactly the reverse happens in dominant males, because dominant males release less NGF in their blood, they have a smaller adrenal volume, and they tend not to be subordinate again. So this is a stabilization effect in which what is now known as social neuroscience, where social roles are very important, especially in mammals, but also in birds and reptiles. And you see that this is, we presented that as a stabilization effect. But what I really witnessed as a generation of people knowing for a long time this field of NGF and other neurotrophin, was that NGF was discovered and labeled as a specific protein acting specifically on the adrenal cells, sympathetic cells, of the peripheral nervous system. And all attempts to see if NGF was also acting in the adrenal areas of the CNS failed for decades. But at a certain point, especially when it was possible to mark and to present, as you see these little black dots, expression of receptors on the neuronal surface, it was clear that many neuronal populations expressed NGF receptors, which apparently seemed that they, if they have the ears to hear the signal of the NGF, they should have some kind of effect. And at the beginning, there was a very strong opposition. And the main explanation, also in textbook, was that neurons expressed receptors for NGF because they used NGF during a very early stage of their differentiation, but in the adult stage, it was not any of not any functional significance. But in several laboratories, including ours, it was possible to see that some hypothalamic areas had immunofluorescence for NGF, and that NGF was in some way playing a physiological role. So I show you one of several contributions we had, because we had the same paradigm in which you have two fighting males, and then we look at those areas of the hypothalamus, and we see this is a normal animal in which NGF is expressed all the time in small amounts, but after a social confrontation, NGF level increase. And we have done this in collaboration with the MRC laboratory in Cambridge with Michel Coder and Maria Grazia Spillantini, and it was clear that were neurons and not glial cells producing NGF. We found a strong increase up to 7-10 folds of specific mRNA for NGF, and so we were pretty sure that stress, social stress, was triggering NGF increase in these hypothalamic areas. This is another coloration in which we see that this is a normal animal in which NGF is all the time produced at a low level, but upon stress, upon social stress, you see that is an increase. And the third one is just a control. Then we have done an experiment more of functional neural anatomy in which we were able to see and to count which were exactly or approximately the neurons producing NGF in brain areas, and we found that we counted between 80 and 90 neurons producing NGF. And then we were looking for a functional role for NGF in stress. And so what we think, or at least I think, is that when you are under stress, your brain and you are looking for a way to have a coping response with stress, and NGF, which exerts such a strong trophic and differentiation effect in the brain, may help to renew the plasticity of the brain, and in some way helps that this coping is in some way embedded in the brain of the animals. Then we were also moving to other cells. These are the surface of mast cells, which are cells belonging to the immune system, and we found that some mast cells are covered, that mast cells are covered by NGF receptors. Mast cells act by moving in certain parts of the body, including if you have burning and you have this red color of the skin, is because mast cells arrive and release histamine, and then you see that rather quickly your part of the body starts to be red. And then they move and they explode. And so we were also showing that as a result of stress, and you have that mast cells are mobilized, go into the peritoneum and explode. And if you take away the salivary glands of mice, you don't have the effect, the magnitude of the effect goes down a lot, but you still have a significant effect, showing that this effect on cells of the immune system is not simply provoked by NGF release in blood. After many years, I have to say, of working on stress and NGF, my colleague Luigi Alove was pushing me, saying, why don't we do some experiments on humans? And I said, listen, we cannot have fighting humans measuring blood, NGF levels. But he said, listen, he was torturing me all the time. And since I've been for many years in the laboratory of Gig Levin in Stanford, and Gig was one of the popes of the stress, I remember, I said, listen, there is a guy in Dublin who is doing experiments on a very peculiar form of stress. The stress experienced by parachutists when they jump out of the plane for the first time in their life. As evolutionary biologists, very few responses are anti-natural, like to jump outside of the plane, because this is a innate or non-learned response with my friends here, in which you avoid doing that. And I was saying that many times, and one day, Luigi, you never say that in front of real scientists, because one day Luigi told me, listen, everything is ready, but you are a very good bureaucrat, you are the Istituto Superiore di Sanità. We need to cope with the informed consent, and I already arranged, and centrifuge are in Pisa, and we go there, there are the parachutists of the Folgore Brigade, and this is this. And I keep saying that it's not really a jump from animal studies to human studies. These are like rats. They are same age, same sex, same diet, and from a biological point of view, they are military soldiers. They are committed to give their blood to the country. So we can get quite a lot of blood out of them. And we found exactly that NGF is released the evening before they jump, because there is a very strong social competition. They get trained, then in the evening, the guy in charge, the officer, say, you and you, tomorrow you jump. And they get very excited. Also horses, rising horses, release NGF when they race. And I was told years after I showed this picture that this is really their first skydiving experience, because when they jump out of the plane for the first time, they have this red stripe, because if they freeze and they forget to open the parachute, this opens the parachute by itself. But NGF is released the before jump here, while the classical cascade of stress hormones is released after landing, because the real problem, outside the fact that you forget to open the, in that case there is no coping response, but the real problem is that when you land for the first time, you can break here, because it's difficult to do that. And after that, I just saw the literature on human being growing. There is all kind of measurements of NGF levels in which all stressing conditions, in the pure definition of stress, conditions in which you cannot control the stressor, NGF is increased. I put some. If you have to care for your spouse and she or he has Alzheimer, you get high level of NGF. If you quit smoking, your NGF is higher. And another very interesting area is what psychologists call passionate love scale. In the case you have a romantic love relationship, believe me or not, in psychoneuroendocrinology, this is well characterized, because it's dangerous. You can go to commit suicide, and it's also in the DSM, in the psychiatric association, so it's not a pathological condition, but you have to keep an eye if it's lasting. You have that NGF is released. But what is really important is that in all these years, many other neurotrophins have been found, characterized. We know the gene, they're proximally are not so different from NGF, but the only one which is specific for social stress remains NGF. Now a few data. Yes, I have time. What we do, we have more recent times. I go back to my field of work, and I wrote a long time ago in a book, a chapter in a book, that was reviewed by Dick Lewandig in the New York Review of Books, in which I claimed something for the liberation of the mice, because mice are caged in pairs, which is absolutely unnatural, because mice live in harems, and males have many females in some cases, but in most of the cases, since, as I said before, males are potentially infanticides, females, like in the case of cats, have all their pups together, and they defend pups, against potential infanticidal males. They treat males like predators. And so the natural condition of the mouse pups in the real world is to have a lot of other pups around, not simply brothers and sisters. So we put again mice in their natural condition, which was, in our case, to be with three mothers, three litters. We know a lot about mouse behavior in retrieving, in nursing, in licking. Retrieving has been scored a lot of fine in psychobiology papers, but again, mice are caged. The real world says that if you have a nest with many pups, the smell of the nest will attract predators, so you have to move the nest at regular times, but this is retrieving, so the mother is licking and grooming. Actually, the mother is eating and drinking the feces and the urine of the pups, and the mother rat, and even more the mother mouse, treats males and female pups in a very different way, which also has profound psychological implications. And so we had these experiments in which we put three mothers with eight pups each. So eventually they have 24 mothers. And we have scored what happens in the NGF levels during the development, but particularly in the long term. So what is the brain level of NGF and BDNF molecules in the case you are reared with a single mother and seven brothers or sisters, or in the case you have three mothers and 23 other pups around you? So the experiment is this. We call communal nesting the condition in which you have three pups, three mothers and three nests. And then you have, we do that before birth up to early adolescent moment, and then we measure in the adult stage what is happening. And these are the kind of tests we do, which are standard test conditions in social behavior and also in cognitive behavior, but I do not have the time to show everything. So in the case of communal nesting, which means three mothers, compared with standard nesting, one mother, is that, as you see, of course, all the is much more that all the time there is at least one mother in the nest. The nursing is more, the licking is more, the stepping, and of course you receive much more quantity of maternal care. And also the interaction between the pups are more sophisticated because they have not simply their own sisters and brothers, but also kind of cousins. And when you go to the adult grooming, adult behavior of these animals, of course, those having more social stimulation during infancy have different social behavior. You see that, for example, allogrooming, which is a classical cleaning the fur of the other animal, which is a kind of amicable behavior, is higher, both in duration and in frequency. And the other two typical behavior, which also dogs express, so sniffing nose to nose or sniffing anogenital area, it's more pronounced in animals in the communal nesting condition. Going to the BNF levels, which is the more interesting thing, we see that hippocampus and striatum, in all areas we tested, the NGF levels is up to seven times higher than in animals socially stimulated when they're young. And we were also looking to the epigenetic effect of this enhanced level of neurotrophins. If we have seen that we have measured acetylation and methylation of DNA, and you see what happens as a result of exposure to treat mothers. You see that in standard nests you have this kind of situation. In the other condition you have another change. You have this opening of the DNA as a result of the early social stimulation. I'm all the time, I'm not good at pushing the right button at the right time. If you were looking up which is the social behavior of these animals coming from a condition of standard nesting or of communal nesting, you see that this is the classical condition, the standard nesting, only one mothers. You see that the dominants have much higher level of attack, while the subordinates have much lower. And if we see what happens for the animal of the communal nesting, you see that what we found is that simply that at the very beginning, with a few minutes of social confrontations, animals having had more social experience were able to cope with that situation, being immediately either social dominants or socially subordinates, since the very beginning. This means that they have done a kind of experience, and so they are able to cope much more quickly to this condition. Here we see the entire panel. If we see also for the submissive animals, that the animals in communal nesting are immediately able to cope with the fact that they become immediately submissive at the first experience. If we look, the level of NGF is the same as in BDNF. Animals reared with three mothers have a much higher level of NGF in their hippocampus or hypothalamus. And you have to remember what I said at the beginning, that NGF is such an important protein for regulating the central nervous system. So you may imagine what does it mean to have sevenfold level of this protein in some so critical brain areas. To finish, we know that social stress is a condition that is also for us, for humans. We have this social coping. We have this mechanism that may serve a renewed brain plasticity to cope with the stressor. And what we have been doing then is to extrapolate to a number of psychiatric conditions, especially depression. We were measuring in several conditions NGF levels in blood and in saliva when possible. We have done that. I don't show you the new data with Daniela Santucci, who is here, also in very extreme stress conditions. For example, military or civil personnel living for long periods in the Antarctic polar stations, even on one Italian astronaut who has been for a rather long time in the International Space Station, which is another abnormal condition. And here there are a little bit of papers we have. Brain plasticity, strange cases like the one I was discussing on television this morning through the TV here in Trieste and Rome, how animal-human relationship may affect some psychiatric or psychological conditions and how neurotrophins are involved in that kind of conditions. and how what we call social skills are important in some way sculpturing the brain of animals by early experience during pre-adolescent behavior or in general brain plasticity. But for my friend Guido, who asked me, what are you doing? Because I have this very large laboratory, which was the laboratory of the Nobel Prize Bovet, so we have many science, different lines of research, including primate behavior. We actually have been doing stress in macaques, also in collaboration with Steven Sumi at the NIH. And so we also work on social fear, and we have done these experiments on great flocks of starlings attacked by peregrine falcons. You may see the name of Giorgio Parisi, who has been involved in the scientific committee here. And we do this work with dogs. We do also this automated way of measuring behavior through automated intellicages. Today I visited this wonderful and up-to-date laboratories here about automatization behavior. And we do also work on migratory birds, because it's very interesting coping response with the terrible effort of migrating. For example, birds that size only weighing a few grams, which cross the Tyrrhenian Sea. They start from Algeria and arrive to the Isle of Ponza without stopping, without eating, without drinking, and they have an incredible stress response. For example, they're able to put down their temperature level at night to save energies at night. Okay, I think I can stop here. I hope I didn't put too much stuff in a single lesson, but was trying to say many things we have done since the early 80s, so thank you very much for your attention.